for the delay, everybody. We just had a couple of technical issues to work out, but welcome to the May 1st meeting of the Hadley Select Board.
March 1st, even.
March 1st. Did I say May? It was wishful thinking. Probably the weather today. So the March 1st meeting of the Hadley Select Board. So tonight, we're actually starting a half an hour earlier than normal, and we will be doing this for the duration of the month for sure, potentially the budget season. So we have a joint meeting with our Finance Committee this evening to discuss two of the public safety budgets and some of the general government budgets. So we're going to start the meeting there. But before we get going, did want to introduce two new Finance Committee members. So with us this evening, joining Amy Feiden-Kevitz, an existing FinCom member, we have Mr. Tom Pitta, and we have Mr. Gabriel Owen. So welcome, both of you. Thank you for your willingness to serve. Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah. So, and I believe, David, that that brings us up to a full complement of Finance Committee for the time being.
I believe that's correct. We have five members now.
Okay, excellent. Okay, so again, thank you very much. Okay, so Mr. Neihardt, our building inspector, has other plans this evening, so we thought we would start with you.
Thank you.
Yep.
I really appreciate you taking me out of order. I know it's a little difficult, but I do appreciate it. So my budget is very simple. There's three line items that have changed. One is office supplies for inspection services. That's been reduced $1,000. That was increased last year for $1,000 for the new code books that were required. And they came in at $984, I believe. So we do have those. So I took that out of the budget. The other two line items are small increases, and that is for the gas inspector. We've increased the tuition by $125 because his certification classes went up in price. The other line item is mileage and meals. He doesn't get meals, but he mileage. We've increased that $85 to try to cover his expenses. Last year he came up slightly short with the mileage. And those are the only three line items that were modified.
David, anything you wanted to add, or?
No, I just wanted to bring your attention to the line 241-5107, the part-time wages. In an effort in order to balance the budget, I looked at the history of that account and decided to recommend a $1,000 reduction there, which we can debate if you wish.
You choose to debate that?
Yes, because just because one year we might not use it doesn't mean that we won't be using it the following year. What we're trying to do right now is because of the move last year and back into this building, we have yet to get all the files back in order. As you're all aware, you've gone into the filing room. It is a tremendous effort. We have brought on somebody part-time, just miscellaneous hours, to put that back in order. There are probably in the neighborhood of 1,000 plus files that need to be addressed that haven't really been closed out over the years, and certainly that person will be a great help in trying to get all that back in order. Last year there was, because of the shift and everything else and what transpired between some of us, we know we did not put the hours in through part-time clerical work, but this year I think there is certainly a need for that, to keep that issue addressed.
Okay. So, question for you, and I'm probably going to be asking this of everybody, where we have project-oriented work, we have not historically done a good job utilizing the offer from the university for internships. Now, nor do we want to use an intern from the university to come in and, you know, do extremely mundane work that isn't necessarily meaningful to them in any way. But on the other hand, if we had somebody either from Eisenberg or from the you know, planning or area or something like that, is that the type of thing that if if properly managed and with notice, is there anything that you might benefit from in that regard?
Certainly, I'm always open to that. That's if that is set up with us, I'd be more than happy to see those people in. We do have a lot of mundane work. It is a lot of filing, a lot of repetition, and it is difficult for people to deal with that. But yeah, if we can set that up, certainly I would use that in a heartbeat before utilizing town monies for that.
It was literal truckloads.
Yeah, but you know, somebody's got to set that up, get the proper people in, and you gotta make sure the hours are right and everything else.
Right.
I agree with you wholeheartedly. The Chinese Emergence School has 20 students over there from the engineering department on the road trying to figure out why Route 9's backing up because of their parking problems, and they're writing the whole thing to try to clarify the whole situation. So they are available, like you're saying, and they could be used.
Yeah, we just need to
And I agree with
plan,
you 100%.
You know, so, and again, that would be our issue, I think, to figure out a way to make it work, but just want to see if you're open-minded to that.
There's only one other thing I got.
Sure.
I don't have a problem with Tim's budget whatsoever, it's fine, but could you give us an update, possibly, what's transpiring out there in this year with new construction, and how's it look for the future? I know the gas moratorium is a thorn in our side.
Yes, it is.
But besides that, what's happening?
The biggest change that you'll see is, last year, the big change was, for whatever reason, they thought that we needed more auto parts stores. So we got 3 auto parts stores in. This year, it seemed like because the Hadley Corners, which is the shops in front of Home Depot, went up quickly and were filled quickly, the thought process was we needed a lot more retail space. And now you can see that there's a number of different buildings going up with that in mind. They're not filling up as quickly as the owners would like. So we have several of those going up. The big change that you're going to see this year is at the Hampshire Mall. There is certainly a proactive role with Pyramid Mall to deal with that. It's not going to be as much retail as we've seen in the past. As with most of the larger malls, they're going to more in the entertainment section. I can't really divulge some of the stuff, but if you go to some of the larger malls and see the entertainment type of spaces, that's what you're probably going to be seeing here over the time. So the certainly we know retail has drastically changed with Amazon and everything, so they're trying to refigure themselves, and they're really doing a huge push there. You're going to see that, but a lot of stuff is stalemated right now because of the gas, and I don't see that changing, and we all don't see that changing.
Did we ever find out about the gas that was used that was shut down? What about that percentage? Is it just poof gone, like gas goes? You know how like Burger King shut down, they had gas in there.
What I've been told from the owners of some of these spaces is that if they don't utilize it within a 16-month period, it's gone forever for them. Mm-hmm. And that has been a problem. When the owner of Hadley Corners heard about that, he went over and turned up all the heat in every single one of the empty spaces, only to show and be able to keep that amount of natural gas flowing. It's been a huge issue. He lost a very lucrative small chain restaurant that he really wanted in there, and he couldn't do it. He tried every way he could, but couldn't get another propane tank on that site. So it's very discouraging for him. The mall is going through the same thing. They were hoping that all the old places that shut down, they could look at that usage, and some of it is gone forever for them. And it's a shame, it really is. Mm. It's not a good
We had a forum over in, and actually it was Amherst Area Chamber that coordinated it. They had asked me to participate on a panel discussion, and the end result of that was we were able to get Berkshire Gas to agree at least to come out, and there's a small working group meeting that's going to happen in the next couple of weeks specifically to address not the bigger picture of the moratorium and all of that, but just this type of issue. And the folks at the mall are definitely involved, so maybe in the next couple of weeks we'll know if it's just same old, or if there's any opportunity for
you know, that. Yeah, originally we understood the new construction, but then when they went ahead and you said 16 months now on an existing unit that didn't use the gas, that's...
Well, there's a house right down the road here that the guy, he has students in there. He decided not to rent. And it was the summer, and he went into the fall, unfortunately, in his renovation. And by the time he was done and he already got the students in, found out they wouldn't turn on the gas.
Yeah.
That's completely wrong. Yeah. There's no reason for that. But that's the way they've been working, and it's them very, very discouraging. So he had to put huge amounts of money at a very quick time frame to turn it over to get on propane. And that means changing all the equipment in there. It's not a big thing, but you know, you start
all the burners have to be converted to for the different pressure.
But you know, why do you have to be that way?
So just coming back to the inspections budget, I had a couple of things, and partially for you, but partially for the board too. Looking at the org charts that David put together at the beginning of it, one of the things that we've talked about a little bit with inspections is the fact that we have three different inspectors and there really isn't any sort of hierarchy, so to speak. And wondering if we should at least have a discussion during this budget season about possibly pulling it into just an inspections division with one, you know, with Tim at the helm of that. So that's just food for thought, and the reason I'm bringing it up is primarily accountability, you know, and customer service, which is the second thought coming back to you. You and I had a little bit of a conversation about the work order system that Marlo brought into the DPW that seems to be working out really, really well. And it's pretty generic. It's an access database, and it sounds like it could pretty easily be adopted for the inspections division if we wanted to track, you know, customer requests or whatever, tickets coming in, and then we could have a better sense of the throughput and then the time it takes to close out these tickets and the like. Is that something that you'd...
We can look at it, but, you know, and the unfortunate problem that we're faced with is, you know, as even today, you know, there were some people that came in. I couldn't tell you, I can have a generic idea what I'm going to do this afternoon, in an afternoon. That can change in an instant, but we can set it up. The nice thing now is I do work very closely with the electrical inspector and the plumbing and gas inspector. They come in almost daily. We sit down, and there are specifics that we go through with regard to especially the larger projects. That has been working well. There is a bit of a disconnect with fire inspections. That's more of their workload more than anything else. But there is a lot of inspections that we do that we have to do jointly. There's a lot of inspections that are back to back with regard to one of us. I like when we worked with the plumbing inspector, because that's under Board of Health, and I told the Board of Health, I'm not trying to take your oversight per se from you, because right now under Mass General Law and the law, how we have it set up in town, that's where they report to. But on the daily side of it, there's such an interaction between all the inspectors, especially them, because quite honestly, I can't and I should not be doing an inspection if there, if the gas or the plumbing doesn't pass.
Right.
So, and it's, we have a good group of people that talk well.
But do you have any system? Do you have an actual system in place, though, any sort of tracking system? Or is it just informal with the meetings?
Everybody's just using their phones.
Right.
That's all we're using right now to track the inspections. And if there's a hiccup, we call each other.
When did you update the building permits? That was a big help when you did that.
That's been a number of years, and we have a new software system. There's some major glitches in it. We're trying to get worked out.
Both DD and I
have made the decision that we're probably going to look at better software. I'm reaching out to some of the other towns to find out specifically what everybody's using. There are better ways of doing it. And the hope is when we get the IT and everything in place here, that we can go to the tablet form. That's going to take a lot of time off of internal office work on punching everything in, because some of these things we can act, if we have the proper software and the proper equipment, we can do it on the spot, and it can go then link back to our computers. So yeah, it's going to be something we can all work on. Like you said, Molly, we've talked a few times. We're going to get into that time frame where we are growing at a significant rate, that we're going to hit that plateau that's going to fall apart.
Time to put some sort of system.
And it is time to put something together, because
before you hit that.
Yeah, and there are some days that it does hit, and there's a huge disconnect.
But anybody have anything else for Mr. Neihardt?
Okay. Pretty black and white.
Okay.
Thank you very
Thank
much.
Thank you. Enjoy your evening.
Love more talk and discussion about what to do with inspection services and get that under control. Thank you.
Thanks, Tim. David, where would you like to go next?
Okay, so it sounds like you'd like to go to the police. If you go to page 55.
Chief
Speed limit 55.
Yeah,
sir. Does this get done with the speed limit of 55? I mean,
yeah, I planned the whole budget book so that I could say
everyone. From 60 to 55, backing up the speed limit.
I'll move a lot faster than that. So.
How you do?
Okay, so I'll do, if you'd like, I'll do the police and the communications budgets back to back.
Sure.
I'll hit the high points. If you have any questions, just let me know. There's about 20 line items in each budget, so I don't want to go over every one of them.
No, we don't want you to either.
Okay,
thank you.
Good. So as far as the police budget goes, I would. It's a 0.87% increase this year, and everybody knows the reason for that. I beat it, to death. Mm-hmm. This summer, when we lose our new officers that we just hired, we're going to be back to where we were, minus one. So I did need to put a little bit of extra money in the overtime line so we can make it through the year. But to give you an idea of whether or not the plan is working, I have very little data to work off of because we just got our folks hired and on the road January 1st. So I have 7 weeks of information I can give you. What I can tell you is that in that 7 weeks, we have reduced overtime spending by almost $6,000. We would have had to fill approximately, using the median overtime rate, we would have had to fill almost $15,000 worth of overtime shifts in that same time span. We fit 9,000. So that's what we're looking forward to when we get our folks back from the academy. But this budget is written to prepare for those first 6 months. As far as the full-time wage line, that's been reduced by almost 17,000, I believe. The reason for that is because we lost some high salaries and replaced them with some low salaries. And when those high salaries left, we lose things like longevity benefits and educational incentives and things like that. So I was able to reduce that line. The part-time line has increased just a bit. That is an increase based upon some of the raises that some of them got from the contract negotiations, as well as In fact, just looking at the schedule and where we believe we'll need shifts to continue from these part-time folks moving throughout the year. The overtime lines, I just explained that one first. That is really, from what I can remember in writing this budget, that is really the only significant increase throughout the whole budget. Overtime training, I'd like to convert that to actually call it just training. We've always used it that way. It's kind of a misnomer, having it named overtime training. It is not just for full-time folks to get overtime when they go to training. It is also for our part-time folks, and we spend a lot of money, as you know, on training. The next one where there's any type of a change is the IT maintenance. We've kind of beaten that one to death all the way around town. IT costs go through the roof. These are things that we have to pay for to keep viruses out of our department. Legal services, that one increased slightly, only because we did have a couple of issues that we had to deal with at the beginning of this fiscal year that completely expended that budget. Planning for the future, I'd just like to add a little bit more to that line. Tuition, that one actually dropped. That's a reduction based upon the actual plan. We don't need to pay, we're going to pay for the academies through for our new folks out of this budget, so next budget won't have to be so high. Gasoline, we reduced that again, not because we're driving around less, but gas costs have pretty much stayed the same as far as we're concerned, and with our new policies in place, we're not leaving cars running and things like that, so we're saving.
New vehicles more efficient than the old cars were anyway?
Absolutely, much more. I don't think we'll, even if they came back out with Crown Vicks again, I don't think we'll ever buy another one. If the other ones are all-wheel drive, the engines are smaller, they're still powerful enough to get us around, and the fuel savings is incredible. So the only other one that's any significant change is the other police supplies, and that's the only, the reason that there's an increase in that one is because we actually consolidated two other lines into that line, and I am anticipating working towards adding Narcan supplies for the next fiscal year. So that's the only reason that budget has changed. We eliminated two other line items and moved the money into that account. So the increase is based upon Narcan as well as consolidation.
So did we benefit from the free program for the Narcan?
We haven't done anything on it yet. I'm not going to purchase the Narcan until I work out the details with the union. It is probably going to be an issue that they're going to want to discuss. So we're not going to spend a nickel until we work out those details. I don't anticipate much kickback on it. I think the officers recognize that even though some other CBAs in the area have bargained and granted them, you know, extra stipends and things like that for doing that. I think our officers recognize that this is something that is going to save lives. So I don't anticipate much pushback, but I'm not going to spend any money until we, you know, get it in.
Right now, the state police carry it.
Yeah. There's several departments that carry this. A lot. It's surprising. I've been doing a lot of research on it. There's a lot less than you'd think. Some of the departments that you would be certain would be carrying it aren't.
No.
Probably because of the same fears that they're going to have to negotiate, you know, thousands
of dollars.
Well,
not only that, but then it becomes a cost, and it's not cheap.
It is. And even with the bargain programs.
I think I gave you the cost of what it was.
And it changes, too. I get a new email from the AG's office. You know, once every 6 months that they've worked out a new deal with a different company and all that. So the prices do change. I've done the research on it, but the problem is that it all expires. All of it expires. So, you know, even if you don't use it, you got to buy it again. Mm-hmm. So you have to factor in that.
It can become like the EpiPen and cost.
What's the life expectancy on it?
I want to say it's 6 to 8 months, something like that.
And there's $600 a use?
Yeah.
No, that's the EpiPen. No, these aren't that much. These are they actually came out with two different ways. They have the nasal annular, and then they just came out with another one that's apparently much easier. It's almost like an EpiPen. It's like a click mechanism. We'll look at the cost and we'll see if we can make it work.
Is that more like a maintenance issue, like you have the defibs too? Is that where
you can?
Yeah. Is that where you would put it?
It's got shelf life.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the problem. What it would be is we would purchase one for every officer, and they would carry it on their person. They'd have their own pack. But after 6 months, it expires. We got to replace it. So if it's $20 an officer or $40 an officer, whatever it is, you know, and if you use it, it's going to go even faster. And, you know, we don't get a ton of them, but we get enough that we'd be using them.
Sometimes you use two or three at once. I mean, you know, it's not just a one-shot deal sometimes.
Right. Now we got more cops.
So anything else on the police budget before he moves to communications?
Would I be correct to say we have 25 officers on the department now?
Including
yourself,
and specials, yes.
Can we do anything to lessen the impact of losing the officers to the academy by hiring more specials before they go to fill those hours?
We just hired two more that we intend on hopefully having trained and on the road before that happens. The problem is that we can only do so much, even with the adjustments that we made to the contract. Once we get down to a bare-bones staff, the labor laws and the way that we had been filling certain shifts with overtime preclude us from doing that. A lot of those shifts will eventually make it to part-timers and specials at a lesser rate, but the full-timers get first right of refusal. So we can do it with some of the shifts, but not all of them. There will be an impact.
It was my understanding we gave up first right of refusals. The officers did in the last bargaining contract.
Not completely. They gave it up in certain areas.
Okay, I didn't know that.
Yeah,
it's a revolving, though, right?
Correct.
Versus seniority. It's a revolving order.
Correct. And if any of the officers, for example, take a day off and they use comp time, that is one of the areas that they gave up first right of refusal, and so those automatically go to a lesser rate. Where this plan really kind of takes hold is when we are at maximum staffing. That's where we make our savings. The problem with what's going to happen this summer is that all three of those new folks that are reducing the overtime by simply being on shift are going to be gone. Plus, one of our folks that would have given us our minimum staffing also has to go to the academy. So we're sending four people. And I also have one officer out injured right now, and I don't know what the status on that is. So even right now with these numbers, with the savings that I'm seeing, I'm very pleased with what I'm seeing, but we're still short an officer, so it's going to get even better once they come back. But just want to prepare everybody for what's going to happen.
What is the maximum number for staffing that you would hopefully wish to have?
As the maximum number?
Well, to make this whole system work.
Well, what we did was is we hired three more officers. We restructured our schedule. So right now we have three officers on every shift.
And you're comfortable with that?
I am comfortable with that from a patrol standpoint, yes. As we move forward and we move towards, you know, more heavily involved investigations with our detective and things like that, it would probably behoove us to maybe look towards hiring maybe one more somewhere in the future so that our detective or our school resource officer can actually devote more time to those tasks.
Right now, they're talking bodies, or are you talking people on shift?
Total bodies to make this work.
Yes, Donna wants to know if the 25 people that you have right now, barring the four people going to the academy, is that staff level what you're looking to maintain in the future at this point in time? Not adding extra shifts or anything, the people that you have are sufficient to fulfill the shifts you have with full-time, part-time, and specials.
Oh, yeah. You mean, are we going to be running with less than what I would hope throughout the summer? No. We'll make it. We're going to make it work. That's one of the reasons why I presented this budget, because we still have a job to do. We have a service to provide to the people of Hadley. We need to make sure that our other officers are on safe as well. So we can't drop down to one officer on the road. No, we have enough to make it work. Unfortunately, because of the CBA and some of the rules that are there, and because of some of the labor laws, it's going to cost a little bit more money.
You won't be bringing us 10 specials in the next 2 weeks, though, to fulfill your quota.
Even if I did, we'd never get them on the road in time. I only have about five FTOs, so.
So on the, I lost it. I'll think of that. Go ahead.
So communications while Joyce is regaining her
Alzheimer's.
The other point while she's thinking is, you know, Hadley is sort of a unique place to work. There's a lot of different activities for young patrol officers, and working in Hadley really looks good in their resumes. So I don't think we have any problem getting younger officers to come and work part-time here.
Yeah, no, and that's the way I've sold it since I was a patrolman here. When younger officers would come on, that's always the way that I've sold being an officer in Hadley, is that, you know, we don't have the staffing to have a supervisor kind of looming over you, so you kind of got to figure it out yourself. And there's enough going on Route 9 that you can perform as like a city officer does, and there's enough community policing things you can do north and south of Route 9 that can give you that small town feel. So I've always sold it that way.
So the thing was, is that during negotiations, we did talk about going down on our staffing during the summer once the colleges weren't in session. So how is this all affecting it now? Are we still
doing it? Oh yeah,
still doing it.
We still drop down to our minimum. We don't staff as many part-timers on extra shifts and things like that. We are very frugal with the way that we handle our schedule right now, and this summer is no exception. The problem is as you know, when we drop down to our minimum staffing, every full-time shift that is vacated, we have to fill with overtime. That was the reason why we need to get those three officers on the road, because now that gives us some wiggle room. When one of those guys takes a day off, we don't have to fill it. Mm-hmm. That's where that savings is coming from.
Okay, communications.
All right, communications.
All right, that's page 59. Sorry, anybody who's following.
So communications, very similar, small increase for the overall budget. It's a 0.74% increase. We made some changes.
Just back up a little bit? Okay. The reason why the chief's numbers and the number that you have here are different is because I gave him more of a haircut than was prudent when we were talking about the building maintenance budget.
Correct.
So the chief has wisely added back in, what is it, $2,600? $2,600 back into his budget that I had transferred over to the building maintenance budget on perhaps a little aggressively. So that's okay. The reason why.
Right. So we had a meeting. The fire chief, DPW director, David and I all had a meeting, and we're trying to figure out a way to consolidate a lot of these building maintenance issues and save some money doing it. So what we did was we're going to take our groundskeeper line and our custodial wages line out of my budget, and it's going to be transferred over to the DPW. We have the same cleaning crew that cleans Town Hall and North Hadley, or one of the other buildings in town that the Town Hall, that David controls in one of his budgets. Because they lost the North Hadley Fire Station cleaning contract, we offered them the public safety. They gave us a better deal on it, so we're saving money like that. What David did cut out, I think it was just because of a miscommunication, was it was a building maintenance supplies account for $2,600. That's just an account that we have always used to buy, you know, tissue paper, cups, plates, things like that. So we still needed that. David, like I said, it was just a miscommunication. He took it out. We just need that back in. Full-time salaries, the increase there is based on the CBA. There's no fluff in there. Part-time salaries, same thing, CBA. They get first right on comp time shifts, just like the full-timers do, so we reduce, you know, they don't get as much overtime as far as the full-timers go. It goes to the part-timers first, so we need a little bit of extra money in there for that. Training wages, that is the only significant increase, I think, in the entire line, in the entire budget. And the reason for that is for a couple of things. One of them is because we do have mandated dispatcher training that they have to do every single year, but we also have optional training that we like to offer just for people to do some continuing ed stuff. I wanted a little bit of an increase in there because of that, and the only other issue, the reason that is such an increase is because we are still working on this 911 grant. This is something that got really messed up when Dennis passed. Transferring it from him to Damien and then Damien to me, we missed out on a lot of funds that we could have been getting, and we actually paid out a lot of money that they are now refusing to reimburse us for. So we're doing this weird dance with the 911 people. They have some of the strangest rules I have ever seen in any grant that I've ever worked on. Just to give you an example, one of the first policies that I wrote when I started was, I call it a double overtime policy. And what we, the way that we used to do things is that when someone would go to a training class, if they worked the midnight shift the night before, for example, or they worked the day shift during the training class, a lot of times they would use a day. They would use a vacation day or a holiday or something. So they're getting overtime to go to the training now. And now I also have to pay somebody overtime
to come in
to fill their shift. So it was double overtime. So I wrote a policy to eliminate that. So now the person who wants to be off of their shift, that's fine, you can have the day off, but you're doing a swap and you're just gonna make day rate at that point. We're gonna, we'll pay to backfill your shift because we have to. Well, we didn't receive too much pushback on that, which I was surprised about. The problem is that when we submitted for reimbursement for all of the 911 training classes, when we did that, they told us that they're not gonna reimburse us for that because it must be an overtime rate. So saving the town of Hadley money and saving the 911, the state money, is apparently a bad thing. So we are out money because of doing things like that. That's the reason why I want to increase that line a little bit, because we're still doing that dance. I'm not going to change that. We're actually saving more in the long run. So we're going to continue doing it, and we're just going to stop putting in for reimbursement on those cases, because I can't justify paying somebody overtime when I'm not actually paying them overtime. I'm pretty sure that's a crime.
If it's a mandatory 911 training, though, you should be able to get reimbursed.
You'd think. That's the only other significant increase in that budget.
Okay. David, did you want to, were you raising your hand? Or no?
No, I'm just scratching my head.
Excellent.
In confusion?
So any other questions, either from the Select Board or Finance Committee in the back row, too? Feel free to... All set for now? Okay. All right. Thank you, Chief. Right. Appreciate you coming in.
Thank you. Did you need me for anything else? Or?
Good night.
Yeah.
Yes.
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 aren't you going to talk to us about the
intersection
here? Oh, yeah, the intersection.
Route 9 at 47.
Yeah, you want to do it real quick.
Can we do it right now?
Sure.
So David called me last week and asked about the intersection out front. I was actually under the impression that Mass Highway would decide whether or not those signs were going back. So that's what I told David. My understanding is that they have jurisdiction over that intersection because it's a state intersection. So when I asked, when I told David that, he assumed the same that I did, and I'm not sure, you know, how the conversation went, but apparently they have turned over jurisdiction of the intersection to you folks. And you can make the decision. So all I can do is provide you with some of the statistics that we gathered. I did it yesterday when I found out that the state doesn't care one way or the other. That tells me one thing. If they don't care, it means that they don't have any measurable statistics that show that those signs are not causing accidents. I did our statistics from the time, I had one of our officers run our statistics from the time that they took the signs down when that project started up until present day, and we have no measurable statistical data to show that any car accidents happened at that intersection because somebody turned on red when they weren't supposed to. I don't necessarily have a preference one way or the other. I think if you're going to put any of them back up, the only one that I would say is not a very clear line of sight is if you're coming south on Middle Street and you look to the left up where the B1 is. It's not the most clear line of sight, but even that one, you still have a little bit of leeway, you know, to make a decision on whether or not you want to go. I did poll a couple of the officers before I came over here, and they have expressed to me that the intersection seems to be flowing freely without those signs there. So I don't really have a recommendation for you. All I can do is tell you that we don't have a problem without them there as of now. It's a small sample size, though, as well.
But if it's under our jurisdiction, to the extent a problem develops, then we could have them put back up.
If a problem develops and Mass DOT does not care one way or the other, they have no data that suggests they should put them back up, then I would imagine that you could reopen it and reopen it, you know, at the board meeting and put them back up.
They're monitoring that intersection with the cameras anyway, so.
Yeah, I mean, well, I don't know how much difference that makes, but the gentleman that we deal with a lot, we get a lot of requests for signage. I get a lot of emails for signage and, you know, in town, speed limit signs, speed limit changes, stop signs, things like that. So we're kind of on a first name basis with the guy down at DOT. He's a civil engineer that deals specifically with streetlights. And when I say streetlights, I mean traffic lights. And signage, where signs go, how far they go. He's a genius when it comes to that stuff. And if he has no, if they're willing to turn jurisdiction over to you folks, like I said, that tells me that he doesn't have a concern there.
So do we want to make a decision tonight then, whether to leave them as is? Or?
Yeah, like I said, I thought we had voted on it before, so I'm ready to.
We started talking about it and then held off until we had data from the chief.
I'm getting a lot of positive feedback from the people that the traffic is flowing. There's still crosswalk signs there, and it's a benefit to us right now the way it is. So I'm going to make a motion.
I haven't had any complaints come into my office. I don't know if you folks have. I've heard any complaints about people.
We just had a request from the senior center, right? I believe the senior center was concerned.
To discuss it.
And specifically the...
Yeah. Well, the problem with the problem with no that well that and usually a lot of times the problem that you have with no turn on reds is the crosswalks, because when people are allowed to turn on red, they look for cars, they don't look for people. So if somebody's crossing the street and you're turning on red,
they've got the new crosswalks there anyway. They're time delayed, and they've got the 15 seconds or so after
Well,
clear.
When the first one gets hit, we can put the signs up.
I make a motion. We leave them as they are. Is there a second?
I'll second that motion.
Okay, so we have a motion made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I don't care, I guess so. Yeah. Makes no difference.
Okay, thank you for staying for that. Okay.
That's the way I'm going home now.
Yeah. Yeah. There you go. One comment before you leave.
We're also going to reduce people speeding down Railroad Street.
Yeah.
I don't know who we owe a thank you to, but 3 weeks ago I complained about the lines in that project where you couldn't see them. Mm-hmm. And yesterday all got repainted. And I think David and Representative Sybeck had something to do with it. And
I don't know who did it, but they weren't listening to my complaints either. So I've been complaining for a lot longer than 3 weeks.
It looks like they're all temporary lines.
They are temporary. That's the other part of it. Yeah. It took 6 months to get them down, and then they're going to ground them all up again in a few months.
Okay, so we're going to have to take a break from the budget discussions, and we do have two appointments this evening. Thank you, Chief.
Thank you.
We have the continuance of a hearing scheduled for 7:15, and then we also have an audience with the Hampshire Council of Government scheduled at 7:30. So 7:15, this was from January 25th. Is that right, David?
That's right. So this is a continuation.
Okay. Excellent. Okay, and this is with Mobilite LLC, and it's a poll hearing.
Yes. Good evening. Thank you for seeing me again.
Sure.
I won't take a lot of your time this evening. I think I just want to update you this evening.
Yep.
Since our last meeting, I met with David, I met with the assessor. I think that we are on the same page as it relates to the contractual relationship that we should engage in for my proposal, the utility pole that I'm proposing over on Mill. I have a couple of questions for you. I've looked at your warrants, and this type of event is happening with a lot of towns that I'm involved in. If I give it, David, I would give it about 2 weeks for it to kick out of legal. They're re-looking at both our agreement on the left and a pilot agreement on the right, sort of kind of maybe merging the two together to accomplish the goal that we need. So it is going to be a pilot agreement in the sense of the Massachusetts law. I've pulled 5 or 6, and I've given it to legal, so the dynamic of the language will be the pilot agreement. Now,
that agreement, I see some warrants for the solar on here. Is that something that we engage in discussions with before the warrant goes out and the will of the voters say it's okay, or do we wait on that?
All right, so if, you know, we had this conversation with the assessors, our approach to pilot agreements is that we always approach it from a win-win situation. We always want to make sure that the taxpayers of Hadley are well represented by the agreement, but that the business community also benefits. So that's our approach. The first question that we encountered was whether a pilot agreement under Massachusetts law for a utility pole or a communications pole was allowed. And we still don't have that answer. Now, pilot agreements, we normally work with solar developers on, because that is specifically allowed in Mass General Law, that in lieu of taxes, and for the people who are following this, when we talk about a pilot agreement, we're talking about a payment in lieu of taxes, pilot agreement. So rather than paying property tax, solar developers work out a business arrangement with the Hadley taxpayers for a different kind of assessment that works to the advantage of the taxpayers, in that in the long term, the taxpayers receive more value for the payments that are made to the town, and for the developer, they receive the benefit of a more manageable cash flow over the life of the project. So we've done 5 of those with solar developers in the past. We have another 2 that are coming up for consideration by the town. We haven't been able to find in Mass General Law a process that would allow us to do this for your communications tower and devices. Let me just outline a little bit. There are 3 levels with a pilot agreement. There are 3 levels of approval. The first level would be with the select board. Second level would be with the town meeting. We need the town meeting vote. And the third level would be with the Department of Revenue. So we need to make sure that whatever we do is agreeable to the select board, to the taxpayers, and above all, conforms to Mass General Law in that order.
Described? Okay. I think we're heading in the right direction. Is it my action? Well, that's a very interesting point, because other town boards are looking at the same quandary. Because I came forward with a right-of-way access agreement that was pretty much straightforward in my world. You introduced the pilot program, which, when you look at the two together, they're very similar in nature. You know, one is based on the assessed value of the chattel, call it, and the other one is based on, call it a more of a landlord-tenant relationship, ground lease sort of thing, where we are seeking access to the right-of-way space. Would it be my action to seek counsel from the Attorney General and the Department of Revenue on my side, because I can do that too, about does my CLEC designation as mobility, as the CLEC, the competitive local exchange carrier, I have the right to be in that space through the state. I understand what you're saying about the telecommunications piece, but it's more of an advancement of the utility with a wireless tenant on top of it. So I think my question here is, I need to seek counsel from the state and the DOR, just like you need to see if we can actually be presented to the voters and the select board as a pilot agreement. Is that what you're hearing?
So I mean, the conversation we had was that you're looking for an exemption from taxation. Any utility pole or communication device that would be put up in town property would be taxed as personal property. And so we take the value of the construction, we multiply it by the mill rate, and that would be your tax bill. And you indicated that you did not want to have a tax bill, that you wanted to make a payment to the town. Instead.
Yes.
And so this is the fundamental problem that we have, is that we don't know of any law that allows us to enter into that kind of an agreement on a telecommunication.
My right-of-way agreement or your pilot agreement based on what I do?
The fundamental issue is that you don't want to be taxed and you're willing to pay in order not to be taxed.
Well, okay, perhaps there's a hybrid there in the sense of I'm willing to pay an annual fee for the right to be in your right-of-way space, and you check, you tax my chattel. If you see, do you see something in that way?
Okay. That could work.
Now, say I want to build a cell tower, right? I build a cell tower, I pay down my ground lease. That's typical. They also assess my chattel. I pay real estate taxes on that tower based on construction costs. So I fill out the building permit. That tower's going to cost me $225,000 to build. You base your tax assessment on that chattel. So perhaps this is the same type of thing. We come to an agreement of annual fee paid for the right to be in the right-of-way space to occupy the space of my pole, which is essentially my right-of-way agreement, mm-hmm. as well as what is that pole worth, what's the chattel on the pole worth, and I, in addition to the ground, I pay you a real estate tax on the chattel. It's a merger of the two.
We'd have to talk it over with the assessors to make sure that it works, but...
And let's run the numbers. I want to see what it looks like.
Yeah.
I understand, mm-hmm. But I certainly don't want to advance something that I... If it's going to be strictly pilot, which I think we're both a little concerned about, if it's strictly pilot, I'm not solar, I'm not wind, I'm sort of over here. I don't want to get it on a warrant and get the will of the voters, and I simply cannot contractually be bound by it. So you want the numbers and how it's all going to look. What I have is basically the cost of my chattel. What's it going to, what the cost of doing this is going to be, similar to the tower. The tower is going to be X amount of dollars. This is how much it's going to be. So that number would be what I would expect to be charged a tax on. Put that over here. Secondly, what's it worth to be to occupy your ground space? Call that number two. So two elements of compensation, and broken down as to how much is the tax going to be and how much is the call it the ground space going to be. Does that sound about right? Sound like it makes sense?
So this is something that we're going to have to work out with the assessor's office.
Yes.
So my recommendation to the board is that we continue the hearing, and or maybe you could even close the hearing and not take any action, and then we continue working with the assessors to come up with a path forward.
Let me ask you this. This still requires a warrant.
Anything with town meeting vote would require a warrant.
What's the cutoff date for May? Is it approaching quickly?
All right. We've already closed the warrant, but it's under the purview of the select board to open it.
I think the absolute drop dead deadline, and this would be dead like a fish left in the sun for a week, would be April 12th.
So what you're saying is my action before April 12th is to get right with the assessor on what here's my fixed hardware cost that I expect to tax on. Mm-hmm. See what he said has to say. Do we need to come up with a verbiage language of an agreement to start to negotiate, or we just need to nail down these two items on how it's all going to work financially?
Yes, to both.
Yes, to both. All right.
And we can help you out with that. We have some model language that can work out.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So what I recommend to the select board is to ask if there's any public commentary. Mm-hmm. Close the hearing and not take a decision until we have further information. And that way we don't have to keep on continuing the hearing from one meeting to the next.
I would do my best to make it before the... I don't want to get too close to the warrant, but I would understand if it doesn't make it. But it is my goal to try to make this happen in 2017.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have something, Jerry? Okay. So
I would think just to continue it if he comes up with that information in the next couple of weeks.
You can close the hearing part of this,
but we can still have audience.
Still defer your decision to another date. But you have to ask if there's any public comment.
Right. So
any other concern?
Yes, there's public comment.
Okay, hang on 2 seconds. Go ahead, John. Finish what you're saying.
I mean, it seems like David has a concern with the AG's office, and you have a concern with the AG's office. And maybe we do need a ruling from them.
Yeah, I think we just need to work out the fine-grained details here, and we don't need to take the select board's time to do it.
Yeah, I think the AG's office has got to be okay with the way it's all transacted here, by the time it comes in the outside, because they look at these things a lot.
Sure, go ahead, Don, you have a question?
Yeah, I do. You know, we just received this morning, and I have a little concern about the pollinator issue and how your poles are going to affect the bees in that area. That's a farming area, and I just want some more information on that to rest my mind in that area.
Yes, David forwarded me some information. I pretty much got on the horse on my side. We have some reports on my side that I can provide, that I have provided into public record. We've also going to retain a certain group of people that specialize in this area, to similar to an RF engineer or an RF expert type of thing, to provide data on this.
I guess after reading through this a little bit, the height and level of your poles affect the pollinators more depending on the height where you put it.
Depends on what you read. But yes, well, I guess I understand what you're saying. So the lower the height, the worse. The higher the height, the better. This is more about the radio frequency levels that are propagating from it and how they affect the humans and the bees. Federal guidelines dictate my activity there. Essentially, this is the way I explain it to it as it relates to human beings. The FCC allows for 100%. They say at this level, you are federally compliant if you navigate to this 100% level. These small cell antennas that I'm proposing are at 0.04%, less than 0.5% of the level of allowed propagation by the FCC. So that's my point. 0.04 of 1% is what these things propagate when I have 100% of that. Explain that properly. I could turn this thing up 99.6% and still be federally compliant. That's to the human being.
And one other thing is, what height have you settled on?
Okay. It's another question that I would like to ask. My review of the ordinance, 55 feet is an allowed use in this industrial district that I'm proposing. I could live with 55 feet. I'd like to understand what my zoning event and my zoning situation would be if I tried to propose 75, add another 20. So I could live with 55, but I'm trying to understand what it would cost me time and if I can get 75 over there, 75 feet. Now, you allow for the 55. My sense is I would go to the planning board and seek, or zoning board of appeals and seek relief for that extra 20 feet.
Okay, and you're still very adamant about erecting your own poles and not attaching to AT&T's poles?
I say yes to that.
Okay.
All right, so public comment? We're trying to get public comment. It's a public hearing. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, I'm Rory Woods, 43 West Street. I'm a beekeeper, and I've encountered these issues. There's a lack of information. So even though I'm sure that you will do your best to provide whatever data you can, I'm not sure we can trust it. So I think we need to really look at this, really look at all the available data, and you know, who produced it? Was it industry produced? Was it, you know, beekeeper group produced? What's the bias? You know, when was it done? And you know, what are these frequency levels and what, how can we mitigate the situation? I mean, the fact of the matter is, we barely have any pollinators left in Hadley. You know, that's the truth. I think I saw 3 last year. And you know, I keep a bee yard in Hadley. It's not a very active one. It doesn't thrive. But that's the situation we're in, is that we're already in deep trouble with pollinators. So you know, I guess you could say, oh, what the heck, we don't have any anyway. Or you could say, well, you know, we're a farming community. We need to do everything we can to mitigate this issue. So I just think we should take our time to really look at this as deeply as possible. Thank you.
Thank you.
Do the beekeepers have any information available on this?
Locally, not so much. The current state apiary inspector, who keeps an office at UMass, is a local person who actually got the job with zero background in beekeeping. She's completely unqualified for the position, and because of that, the local beekeepers have been abandoning our county crews, our county, pardon me, beekeeping groups, because it's futile. Nobody really wants her to know where we keep our bees, because nobody can trust her.
I was gonna ask you about UMass. If they're a large group, do you think anybody over there has any further information, or is that your point on UMass?
My point is that the state apiary inspector, who is based at UMass and is running the situation, is completely incompetent.
Okay. I think my point is...
These views are held by one person. They're not necessarily the viewpoint of the select board.
You could talk to Dan Conlin, who's been running the Franklin County Beekeepers Association and started it, 30 years ago, and I'm sure he would tell you, he would give her a glowing recommendation. I think you'd find that he has some vested interest in giving her a glowing recommendation.
To address your point, because this concerned me. In my 2 decades, I had not heard about the pollinators and the bees.
The extension.
I've been doing it a long time. So I reached out to some people that had knowledge, and the initial feedback is there's an awful lot on the internet. If you look at both sides of this, awful lot on the internet about certain studies in various places, Germany, Finland, all these places, the bees are everywhere, that have conducted studies. And then our side is a little light on their studies, but there are some. So I think his role would be more to, let me try to validate any and all of these on this side. Does any of them validate each other? That's another scientific point. A lot of studies can get done, but if two scientists don't agree on the validity of a study, then it really doesn't mean much. So my guy will look at anything I ask him to look at. So my goal is to try to make everybody comfortable in this bee issue, including myself. I don't want to kill bees.
Madam Chair, I'd like to hear somebody independent, maybe somebody from the entomology department at the university department, and come in and speak to us on this subject matter. Well,
that would be up to us to produce
That would be my suggestion. Somebody that's completely neutral, and let's hear what they have to say,
Okay. So,
motion to close?
Yeah, we need a motion to close the hearing. We're late for our 7:30 appointment. Yeah.
How many of these poles do you intend to put in?
I think I have two right at the moment. That one being the first. The
second in total?
In total on my list, yes, sir.
No, you said something about a cell tower?
This is not a cell tower. I think I used the word cell tower as an example of what I was trying to talk about in the taxes. I don't call this a cell tower. It's a utility pole with a small cell attachment on top of it.
So we have a motion to close the hearing. Do we have a second?
Second.
Okay, motion to close made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye? Okay, and then we will have audience with you in the future.
Thank you.
Okay, all right, thanks for coming. Okay, I apologize, we're late for our 7:30 appointment. So we have the Hampshire Council of Governments with us this evening. Todd, welcome.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. How are you?
Good, thank you.
Good seeing everyone.
Thank you.
Have a brief presentation and also hot off the press, our FY16 annual report. It's just published. This isn't the final bound version, but we wanted to print some off for you for the meeting. I wanted to allow your town administrator to maybe kick things off for us, and then Alan and I, our purchasing agent, are here to answer any questions and go over the presentation.
So the town of Hadley is a member of the Hampshire Council of Governments. We participate in a number of programs, the first of which is the purchasing program, whereby we get highway supplies. This would be salt, sand, street sweeping supplies, guardrail supplies, tire supplies, most of the consumable supplies used by the Department of Public Works we received through the cooperative purchasing program through the Hampshire Council of Governments. We also participate in two ways with the Hampshire Power program. The first is that we have a fixed rate contract for all of our electricity, which is good until October 2019. So we are insulated from the fluctuations of energy prices having to do with electricity for all of our accounts. The second way that we participate is that we entered into a net credit metering program through SREC 1 for 70% of our power supply. That's five facilities that the public safety complex, it's the two schools, and it's the two treatment plants. Those combined represent 70% of our electrical use. We receive a 21% discount on our energy costs for the next 20 years on that. That's a substantial savings. So the third way that we participate with the Hampshire Council of Governments is through our Hampshire IT program, whereby we receive a reduced rate for our computer services through Paragus for our routine computer work. So that's where we are right now.
I don't know how you would like us to proceed, Madam Chairman. Glad to kind of breeze through the presentation and give you a brief update as we did last year, and then answer any questions that you may have as we review the materials. So thank you very much for having me. Just want to give a moment for Ellen to introduce herself as well.
Yes, I'm Ellen Batchelder. I joined the Hampshire Council just about a year ago. So I'm the Director of Procurement Services there. And I think I will also hand out these folders, which also provide some information in terms of the specific bids that the town participates in, both from the town as well as the schools. There's a little bit of detail there on the left-hand side.
So the, as you know, since we've been here before, but for the sake of your audience and those in the room, the Hampshire Council of Governments was chartered in 1999 after Governor Weld abolished the counties of Western Mass, kept the ones in Eastern Mass for some reason, but the citizens and the communities of Hampshire County decided to have a form of regional cooperation, so they chartered and formed the Hampshire Council of Governments as a volunteer municipal cooperative governmental body. The mission of the council is to drive economic development and improve quality of life in Hampshire County and beyond by offering a robust suite of services that combine the best practices of government and the private sector in support of municipalities, residents, nonprofits, and local businesses. Over the years, we've created that suite of services, and we're always looking to expand it. So hopefully by the end of this evening, we can also talk about what are Hadley's additional needs and how we can work together to form sustainable new services for the town of Hadley and beyond. David did a good job of mentioning many of the services that the town partakes in. Obviously, one of our core revenue generators is called Hampshire Power. We are a competitive licensed electricity supplier. We are the only nonprofit electricity supplier based in the Commonwealth. The main goal of Hampshire Power is to bring savings to our customers and also to keep some of that $22 billion that the Commonwealth spends in electricity back here in the Commonwealth. Fortunately, most of our utilities, as well as all of the competitive suppliers that operate in space, are based outside of Massachusetts, and that really is a gaping hole in our economy, so we try to keep as much of that revenue back in the Commonwealth as possible. We do offer a fixed rate product that has been serving about 90,000 residences and businesses throughout the Commonwealth. And we also serve direct business-to-business contracts with municipalities such as Hadley, as well as nonprofits and school districts throughout the region. Hampshire Solar, as also David mentioned, is our solar net metering program. It brings a 15% savings to your electricity bill through net metering credits. That's also available to residences, nonprofits, and businesses throughout the valley. And we have many folks signed up here in Hadley. And in fact, one of the prime solar arrays is also located here in Hadley. And that has about 40 area residents benefiting from that program directly through that solar array. I want to turn it over briefly to Ellen to talk about the purchasing cooperative and some of the work that she's been working on for the purchasing cooperative in relation to Hadley as well.
So in the folder that I provided to you on the left-hand side, there's a flyer that basically outlines the various bids and programs that we are working with here at the purchasing cooperative. So there's a number of different bids, products and services that are available. The sheet that is highlighted in the town of Hadley at the top, that shows the purchasing history specifically for the town departments. And you'll see it's a quarterly comparison, 2015 to 2016, for each of the bids that the town has participated in. And then way over on the right-hand side, you'll see that there's a comparison year to year, which shows the variance in terms of, you know, which bids, the utilization of bids that went up, which ones went down. And I was looking at it earlier, and just a couple of things that I, you know, saw on here really was about halfway down the page, you'll see that the usage on hot mix asphalt went up significantly during 2016. I'm sure there was a very large highway project going on in town. And one of the ones that we saw drop was the salt from 2015 to 2016, obviously because of the comparison of the two winters. So this data is provided to us by the vendors. Part of the bid is that they are required quarterly to tell us who participates on each bid and what the dollar value is. The second page that is stapled to that provides an estimated savings number. And these are figures, some legacy figures on the estimated discount percentages that have been utilized, but it gives you an estimate per bid based on the dollars spent of an approximate discount. And one of the figures that we're looking at, or one of the things that we are doing with the new bids as we're sending them out, is requesting that figure from vendors, so that when they place their bids with us and give us their pricing, they can say this represents X amount of a discount off of, you know, standard, their standard fees. So the second page, or the second set of pages here too, is also for the Hadley schools. And you can see that the Hadley school systems do participate in a few bids, and their value, the value that they spent between 2015 and 2016, was just approximately about the same in terms of the bids that they utilized. So the purchasing cooperative is definitely interested in working with the towns in terms of providing whatever type of support we can from a procurement standpoint. We are, you know, we've done a survey with all of the area DPW superintendents to see what type of bids would be helpful to them. We're working on one right now for tree services, so we're developing the specifications for that and hope to include that in the assortment of highway products and services that we request estimates for.
So it looks like it's about 3.5% discount? A little bit. North of that,
3.6.
Yeah, 3.6. If you look
overall
at that overall.
Average.
Yeah,
yeah.
Does that sound about right?
You average it out. Mm-hmm. Also, under the purchasing co-op, we have the Hampshire IT program, which I believe now is in its fifth year that Hadley also participates in. That's a partnership with Paragus Strategic IT, which is based here in Hadley, a local company. That's where municipalities and nonprofits can bundle their IT purchases together. So the more towns or nonprofits that join that service, the lower the rate gets. Obviously, that rate is negotiated roughly every 2 years just to account for inflation. We had a good meeting yesterday around Paragus IT. Glad to answer any questions you have on that.
What's your feedback been regarding Paragus?
In terms of?
Their responsiveness, their ability to service the customer, that type of thing.
Yeah, very good. So they serve the HCOG as well as the Hampshire Group Insurance Trust. They also serve several nonprofits, and I think we're up to 8 or so municipalities that they're serving, Orange being one of them, Hadley, Hatfield, et cetera. I think with any IT company, you're going to run into some hiccups, especially as either staff changes or technologies change. I think one thing that we've been working on with Hampshire IT and Paragus is that really the towns are all in this together. You're facing some very similar issues, and so we want to open up a better dialogue between all the towns that Paragus is serving so that we can start learning from each other. That's something that I think is going to help tremendously. Also, Paragus recently went through a restructuring process where I think they really focused on communication
and making sure that the towns are more aware of what paragus can do and what they're set up to do versus what perhaps they are not, where we may need to find additional assistance. So I think they are working on it, and like any company, there are some hiccups along the way, but hopefully we've been able to sit down with David and address any of the needs or concerns that the town had recently.
You guys had a meeting last week?
Yes, just yesterday.
Okay.
To express concern.
To express some of the concerns, because I'm getting a lot of the feedback that are significantly concerned regarding the response time and things like that, and their ability to handle the problems that we have. So I'm glad to hear that you had a chance to sit down and talk about it. Was it clearly outlined, the problems that we're having along the way and other things?
What we talked about was ways of strengthening the relationship, talking about the strategic vision going forward under the 5-year strategic plan. We talked about ways that we can improve the communication and the service, customer services. I don't have the background in IT to be able to address particular IT problems, but we talked about the need for clear communication, outreach, responsiveness, as well as an organized way of moving the town forward.
In our SWOT analysis that we've done, Todd, over the last year and a half, it's been clear to everybody here within the town that if we had a better IT situation, that there, many hours would be saved from people communicating back and forth to each other. So I think we've identified that as one of our key things to make sure that we work on to get taken care of, because I think it brings the most advantage or the biggest advantage to us to solve that problem and get it fixed. So just to understand our concerns with that are significant.
No, I agree with you, and we've asked Paragus to look at that strategic plan that you had completed and also really overlay some things that have changed since then, such as public meeting law changes, and so just make sure that you're as set up as you can be to go forward and tackle that strategic plan over the next 2 or 3 years, and working with Paragus to make sure that we do that in the most cost-effective manner possible.
Molly?
Is this relative to Paragus?
Yes, Mike Serdinsky. Yep. I sit on the planning board.
Yep.
And apparently Paragus put together this 5-year.
Nobody
came and asked us what our needs were. I'm just curious if they didn't have the foresight to figure out that there were certain boards in town that really need to talk about what their needs are from a technological standpoint, IT standpoint.
Yeah, okay. I think this was addressed at the all boards meeting.
Oh, okay.
Mr. Dwyer brought it up.
Okay.
And so several of the boards weren't part of that, and so I think we're committed going forward. It was actually Northeast IT Consulting that did it.
Okay, sorry.
But they were specific to the employees.
Thanks.
So.
Thanks.
But we'll make sure you guys get wrapped in, because we know your needs are great.
Okay. To your statement about the Public Information Act there, is there anything that you people can help the towns with getting grant money from the state?
Yeah, it's a great question. So I think some law firms have been able to hold kind of free workshops to get the ground going. We're looking at that and in touch with some to see if there's some more services that can be bundled together and regionalized, if you will, to bring some additional guidance and assistance for municipalities to begin tackling that. I know you guys have a good kind of master plan around this on your website. And as I said, I've asked Paragus to take a look at that and see what kind of IT issues we need to integrate into that. And then the COG and Ellen's purchasing cooperative are looking at various things within kind of the mandates of that law to see if there's any place else we can step in and assist.
Yeah, and I, at the selectmen's meeting, I had spoke with Ellen, and there was a lot of other selectmen boards throughout the Berkshires and Franklin County that are members of the association. Kind of on a bigger picture, out in Western Mass, if we all got together where we could have a little bit more say-so in Boston and get some type of grant like that for everybody out here.
Yep, I agree, and that's one of the strengths of the Hampshire County Selectmen Association. They do draw from Berkshires and Hamden and Franklin counties as well. And we did host the legislative summit back a couple months ago, and there were some issues raised around, and we had the treasurer come and speak, the state auditor, Ms. Bump, come and speak about unfunded mandates that all the towns, particularly the small towns, have to shoulder. And what came away from that, I think, with the legislators and Senate President Rosenberg, was that there really does need to be a bit more of a concrete, solution-driven process to look at all the things that these smaller, medium-sized towns are asked to do, but without the funding resources to make that happen. We're certainly looking at ways to create services that can assist, but I think we need to work with a delegation as well and see if there's some additional money that can come in to bring some of those solutions to bear.
So Todd, can you talk about one of the things that we had talked about, making sure you're prepared to discuss tonight, was really the kind of the overall health of the COG?
Sure.
I mean, obviously there's been a fair amount of press on the topic, but you know, one of the concerns we'd have is that it doesn't seem that the Hampshire COG is growing in terms of participating municipalities. Mm-hmm. And the clear lion's share of the revenue, on the expense, but the revenue is coming from the electricity program.
Yep.
And you know, that's really funding pretty much everything else there. So I know that you had indicated that this year you felt that the financials were, you were going to see a turnaround and maybe start coming into the black on that program. Mm-hmm. But you know, just from our standpoint, obviously, to the extent we're continuing with these purchasing efforts, you know, we don't want to find ourselves in a situation where the COG runs into trouble and all of a sudden the rug's pulled out from under us midway through a fiscal year.
No. So would you like me to jump on that right now and hold off on the rest of the services and get back to that?
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought you were done with the service side of it. Yeah.
I don't want to ignore your question. Actually, let me just finish running through this real quick about the other services, and then we'll jump onto that immediately because I think it's a great question. Partly inspired by your website, which was an excellent website, and I think hopefully is holding true for you. We launched a service called Hampshire Web, which brings low-cost municipal websites to communities. Obviously, you're not going to be participating in that, but if you ever do choose to upgrade your website with the company that did your website, who was the chosen vendor, I recommend you go through Hampshire Web. It's going to offer you a savings on the overall cost of that upgrade. Obviously, also housed under the Council of Governments, particularly the councilors who are also the trustees, is the Hampshire County Group Insurance Trust. That is one of the largest and most successful health insurance trusts operating in the Commonwealth. I am not the director of that, but we could certainly bring Joe Shea in to answer any questions that you may have around that. One program that wasn't mentioned, but is one of the cornerstones of the HCOG, is the Retired Senior Volunteer Program. That is a federal grant, and I'm pleased to say we just received notice yesterday that it will be funded for the upcoming federal fiscal year. And it brings about 100,000 volunteers throughout Hampshire and Franklin County, volunteers that are over 55 years old, to work for nonprofits throughout the valley and bring their expertise and services that they've developed over a lifetime to those nonprofits. And we have some concrete data on how that's working here in Hadley as well. We also house the Tobacco-Free Community Partnership. They work with communities to address youth smoking and also smoke-free housing. And they've been working here in Hadley as well. We also offer green community support, the Meta Grant Administration and support. And as mentioned, we do the administration for the Hampshire County Selectmen's Association. We've recently had three Hampshire Town workshops where we focus on issues that are pertinent to the communities of Hampshire County and have workshops based on them. We had about 90 people attend a town meeting, how to run a successful town meeting workshop held in South Hadley last year, and we hope to continue with that program this year and have quarterly meetings as well. So the last page really just shows the savings and the value. So for example, looking at the Retired Senior Volunteer Program, we have about 9 volunteers from Hadley in that program. And within the town of Hadley, the volunteers, grand total annual, put in about 1,236 hours, which is about $35,000 worth of service to the nonprofits based here in Hadley, as well as your senior center. Also looking at we also have an SREC program, which I didn't talk about, where we broker the solar renewable energy credits on behalf of homeowners and solar owners. People have solar on their roof. There are 41 customers in Hadley that we broker their SRECs for. As I mentioned, the solar net metering credits, we have 40 people throughout the valley who are drawing on the net metering credits from the solar array that's located here in Hadley.
Obviously, we're available on the web and Facebook for any additional issues. Just a couple things that we're working on in the future. We are looking at some changes in the purchasing cooperative where looking at towns that can be more contributory to the program in that some of our more medium and larger towns are issuing RFPs or engaging in services that could be available for the rest of the towns as well. And we're looking at, well, if we can tap the strength of another community that's a member town, use that RFP, regionalize it, and turn it into another service of the purchasing co-op, then all of the towns that fall under the purchasing co-op can start using that service at a discounted price. And then we could do a revenue share program with the town that actually created the RFP in the first place. So we're looking at more of a reciprocal relationship for some of the towns that are taking the initiative to tackle some of the challenges that you mentioned. We're also looking at possible ways where we could get more involved in shared services support. A lot of that has been happening through the DLTA money, District Local Technical Assistance money, which flows to the regional planning agencies. Unfortunately, we are the only regional entity in the Commonwealth that does not receive DLTA funds because we are not a regional planning agency. We are just a COG, and that is a unique situation to be in. So we don't have that availability of state funds, which we would use to really, we would see it more as seed money to create a sustainable program that could serve the needs of municipalities over time. But we do hope to work with the towns that are thinking about more kind of shared service models and see how we can assist and bring kind of our business sense, if you will, to be able to create a program that's going to stand the test of time and not be dependent on grants. Because eventually the grant landscape changes, grant money goes away, and you need something that can still be there and not bankrupt the communities and serve them a little better. So very interested in hearing your thoughts on additional needs. And if you will, Madam Chairman, I'll jump right into the health of the COG before we get into that. So I did, you'll notice in the annual report there are some financials, but I brought something that hopefully will bring a little bit more clarity. So these are audited numbers. We do not have our final audit for FY16, but the numbers presented herein are presented or prepared by the auditor.
Excuse me, Todd, you got an extra one for the former counselor from Hadley?
Sure. Thank so the first page compares FY15 and FY16, and then the third column is a year-over-year growth. So you do see in FY16, our general expenses increased by $76,000, but Hampshire Power revenue increased by 442%. It increased by $572,000. You do see that in FY16, the COG finished a total in the black of almost $90,000, a year-over-year growth of 122%. So those numbers show that while FY15 and probably all the fiscal years before that were challenging and ended in a net loss, FY16 did show a turnaround and a net positive position. There's a lot of work to be done. Let's talk about how unique the COG is. The COG receives almost no tax money. So the total assessments of the communities that are members of the COG contribute roughly $25,000-$27,000 towards the COG. As you can see, our budget is well in excess of that, upwards of $9 million or so. The vast majority of that revenue comes from our fee-for-service programs and services, and obviously Hampshire Power is the biggest of those, and that's why it's very important to the organization. However, we have been working on diversifying income streams. So Ellen was brought on in part to bring her expertise to have the purchasing cooperative finish in the black. It had traditionally finished in the red. As you may remember, the purchasing co-op used to be free for all towns and vendors including and vendors included, but we do have a small administrative fee attached to it to pay for salaries and the expenses of the purchasing co-op. Our SREC service has increased in revenue year over year, as you can see in the annual report, as has the Hampshire Solar revenue as well. And we're always looking to diversify revenue streams, but at the same time bring a service of value to our core constituents, which are municipalities, nonprofits, and the businesses and residents that make up our communities. So hopefully that provides some context on the finances of the COG. I'll note that it is challenging that every year the COG starts in about a $600,000 hole every single year, and that has to be, those are general administrative expenses, and that has to be made up through the revenue generated from the rent of portions of the courthouse, and the remainder has to be made up by our fee-for-service programs and services. So we're always looking to shed expenses wherever we can and build up a more robust revenue stream. So you are right to be concerned. We always should have been concerned about the COG and its financial sustainability. It was created oddly. If you read our enabling legislation, it's one of the most interesting pieces of enabling legislation I have ever seen. It has really saddled the organization with some serious challenges, but the board and certainly the staff are committed to doing their best to make sure that the COG is in a financially healthy place year in, year out going forward.
The cash flow? Your cash flow, is that probably just say there's a line of credit out here for $300,000?
That was paid off yesterday.
Okay, all right. Yeah, because I'm just looking, just at the end of the year, the $2.7 million in accounts payable and basically just a corresponding amount in accounts receivable, so I would imagine it's pretty tight.
Yeah, obviously we need to finish every year net neutral plus a dollar. I mean, that's really where you want to be as a nonprofit governmental body. We're not in the business to make money, but we're not in the business to lose money either. So we need to work on generating revenue to bring it to a net neutral position. Some of the issues or some of the things in the financials that you'll be probably seeing is we're also renovating the old county courthouse. So that money was expended, the money came in the last fiscal year. We're also seeking reimbursement from some Community Preservation Act funds from the city of Northampton. But the building restoration is again a net neutral situation where that's not gonna end up costing the COG additional money.
Do you own the building?
The building is technically owned by the quote, inhabitants of Hampshire County, as it says in the deed from the 1700s.
That's why they were coming to the CPA. And what about this year's, so the budget, this is just from your website. This was the 2017?
No, that's not done yet. So that should be the 16 budget. Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, no, so that, budget. Yeah, no, yeah. So this is the current year one. How is the performance against this budget in terms of revenues and expense?
It seems to be on par-ish with last year. I think we're going to be finishing very close to a net neutral position as well.
Did you have your hand up?
I was just curious what year-to-date numbers looked like. I used to, Mike Serzinski, I used to serve on the COG, and I was on the finance committee, so I tried to pay close attention to these numbers. I do know that historically, what has been budgeted never comes to fruition. Last year, the budget that was presented to you people showed a $2 million gain for electricity, and it got slashed significantly. So the electricity markets are very volatile, and what we think is going to happen doesn't necessarily happen.
Well, I'm just looking at the, and Todd, make sure I'm looking at this.
Sure.
So you have budgeted $11.2 million this year for revenues for the electricity program, right?
So that's revenue. So
yeah, just revenue.
Yeah. So when you think, when you're talking, so that's all fees that are coming in the door.
Yep.
Okay.
So then is that the comparative to the $7.8 million from 2016?
Yes, on a cash basis.
Okay, so you're expecting to go from $7.8 million to $11.2 million in 1 year?
It probably won't make 11, but it should be up there. I mean, so that's driven by load. It's driven by the cost of electricity. That's also driven by the fees that other vendors collect, which flow through our bank accounts, but we never, you know, it's just a flow through type of situation. So you're going to see equally large numbers on the expense side.
Yeah, so that's the corresponding expense side then. If you're not making the $11 million, nor are you incurring $10.5 million, so that would be ratably decreased.
Right, so if Hampshire Power at the end of the year ends up with a net profit of, say, $700,000, that'll bring the COG to a net positive position of about $100,000, using very rough math. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you're going to find me.
Okay.
Well, one of the reasons that we had such a good year, the COG had such a good year last year, is because they had some municipal aggregations, primarily in the northeastern part of the state. Lancaster, Lowell, Haverhill, Marlboro, and some of these have been renewed, and some haven't been renewed. Can you talk a little about that, Todd?
Sure. So we do serve municipal aggregations as a competitive supplier. All those contracts that Mike just mentioned are still active, but for Marlboro, which we lost for a six-month period. That's going to be coming up for bid again very soon. In the interim, we also acquired a couple other aggregations as well. And then the other element of our Hampshire Power product is what we call the retail book, which is our direct business-to-business contract with municipal accounts here in Hadley and 100 other or so customers scattered throughout the valley. And that is another important source of revenue for Hampshire Power.
Okay. So could we get your year-to-date actuals on this just through? That would just be helpful just to kind of see how it's tracking.
And they'll be on a cash basis.
Yep. And this is also cash basis, or this is accrual?
Is that the audit?
Nope, this is the...
Oh, that's the budget.
This
so
is
the
budget. Yeah, okay. Okay, that'd be good.
The reason why I just mentioned cash basis, so in electricity, you know, $200,000, $300,000, $400,000 checks go in and out of the account every day. And if you stop the numbers on one day, it's going to show one thing. If you stop them 2 days later, it's going to show something else. So we always say it's good to look at cash, mm-hmm. but also look at it on an accrual basis as well.
Okay. Other questions for Todd or Ellen?
I just got one statement. Yep. I would publicly like to thank Mr. Sarzynski for his 4 years of service to the COG and for the time
more
he's
than
taken.
For how long? How many years?
It was more than four.
Yeah, but that's okay.
How many was? I thought it was only.
What are numbers between friends, right?
That's true. And I thank you again for bringing me up to stuff to know exactly what's transpiring. It's so different. When I lived in Belchertown for a short term, I was on the COG for almost 3 years, and we sold the hospital because we were losing money there. We tried to feed it into the electric company. We applied for residential aggregation. The application wasn't accepted by the state. It cost us an awful lot of money, and we're still feeling the pain from that, I think. There's a lot of changes going on right now in the COG. And we don't have the revenues. It's quite obvious. Everybody's talking about it at an executive level and a full board, and we're trying to deal with that today, and hopefully we'll have some remedies for that in the near future. But it's not an easy situation the COG is in, like Todd said. They don't have the ability, like cities and towns, to raise revenue through taxation. They have to do it through fees and things of that sort. So it makes their job much more difficult to accomplish, you know.
John, do you
have a... I'm sorry. We welcome Donald, and we also thank Mike for his service, and welcome Donald to the board. He's a good counselor for you.
Good. John?
Question. How many towns belong to that COG?
15.
15? And how many towns in the county?
20...
I want to say 29.
29
is the,
yeah.
No, it's 20.
20.
Yeah.
Okay, that was
21. 20 or 21.
So part of the challenge is that Northampton and Amherst are not participating in the COG, and Northeast Hampton, right?
Yeah. How much money they actually save a year by being a member of the COG?
That's the information that was provided tonight. We have to take a look at that, but that's on information.
They don't have a total?
Yeah. We've got a handout of it. Do you have another handout of that?
Yeah, you can have mine.
No, I guess
it's 21,000.
It's 21,000 for the purchasing program for the town, and then I believe another 11 or so for the schools.
And what does it cost to belong here?
Yeah, what were the fees?
It's insignificant.
$3,500
or something like that.
Can you say that again, Dave?
$3,500.
$3,500. But, you know, part of the evaluation is always, you know, can we get those savings elsewhere? Is this the best bang for the buck? So we'll be talking about that during the budget season. Mike?
It'll come up in your budgets in the next part of your conversation.
Yeah. Just one comment on cash versus accrual. If financial analysts would pay attention to what was going on with the cash at Enron versus what was being accrued, people would be a lot happier.
So we're looking at
number,
the cash.
Number two, you know, 6/30/16, and this has been a problem. The cash balance was 1.27 million. I believe it's closer to a million now. 4 or 5 years ago, after Hampshire Care was sold to the Masons, the cash balances are, I think, $4 to $5 million. So the trend has been down, and something has to be done to stop this hemorrhaging of cash. Last year was a decent year. The question is, can you repeat, 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 repeat?
Right.
Okay.
So the information is that for the current fiscal year, our fees are $3,625. For FY18, the assessment's going to be $3,183, which is a $442 decrease.
So thanks for the time. I think in terms of services, you were just asking.
Yes, yes.
Last year, I think we definitely hammered on the IT piece of it. And I guess it's a question of, again, Paragus is providing day-to-day work order ticket service, but yet when we we're looking for that, the bid to come up with a five-year plan, it wasn't really IT consulting per se. It's more just kind of, again, just hourly click charges. So an enhancement there would be warranted. And then I think we also spoke to you about the accounting. You were just getting your municipal accounting program up and running. We've contracted with an independent third-party vendor. It's an area of ongoing interest for us, for sure.
Yeah, so. And we do have some availability. I don't know if you're looking for 100%, you know, full-time accountant, but certainly our staff of two are available to assist and bridge gaps and provide support for that.
Madam Chair, I want to bring up the other thing that our full board is in agreement, and this is human services. We don't really have a human services department in our town. Most of the hill towns don't have any. Naturally, Northampton, East Hampton, much bigger Amherst do. And maybe that's something for the future to look at to bring revenues in.
Now, that's a great idea. Human services on really kind of two macro levels. One, personnel policies. We all spend a lot of money reviewing and updating our personnel policies, and frankly, most of the towns are very similar, and there's probably a cheaper way to accomplish that for a lot of the communities. And then two, just day-to-day HR, how to hire, how to fire, how to deal with issues that come up in a community. So that's a great idea, Donald. We'll look into that and maybe work with you to craft a scope of services that we could turn into an RFP.
Thank you. Did we not generate a few of the things that we were talking about in advance about 3 months ago? Of things we were looking to see if the COG was available to provide us with. Mm-hmm. Didn't we generate a list of that? Mm-hmm. Can we forward that on to Mr.
Sure.
Ford when we get an opportunity, please?
Yeah.
Which is, I think, what he was looking for,
right.
Anyways.
Awesome, thank you.
Okay, any further comment tonight before we let the folks from the COG go? Our invited guests?
Thank you very
no?
much.
Did you?
I didn't come here specifically to talk for or against the COG, but I'm Gary Brown. I'm the town administrator of Belcher Town. We've had a long history with the COG. We have had some successes and more failures. The COG, as Mr. Ford indicated, is a unique organization. It's not a one-size-fits-all. It provides more convenience to small towns than it does for larger towns. And no one should be criticized or praised for their level of participation or appreciation or lack thereof. You've been given some materials tonight. I would encourage you to look at those very closely. The municipal electricity program that had been offered is not competitive if you do your homework. There are much better deals out there. The residential electricity program, similar. There's some great deals out there. So if you just take this leap of faith and trust that you're getting the best bang for your buck, that's your choice. That if you're comfortable with that, that's fine. If you're aggressive with your purchasing and you do your homework, there are better deals out there.
I'm sorry, Gary, you said you're from Belchertown?
That's correct. Okay. That's correct. There are other concerns that we have in Belchertown. In fact, we had a tempered discussion at our meeting on Monday night about withdrawing, and that has not been resolved. There are management problems, there are cash flow problems, there's a lack of accountability, all of which should be concerning to the member communities.
Okay, thanks for your comment.
Thanks for taking the time to join us.
I just got a question. Mr.
Yep.
Brown, I know normally in the past you've taken votes in Belchertown to withdraw and they've always failed. And what I can't understand, everything that was in the paper, and a lot of it was bad press, I think. I didn't enjoy reading that article at all. And if there's such a problematic area in Belcher Town, why aren't the select board behind you? You know, you keep bringing it up. No, no, but I'm asking.
I appreciate what you're saying, but I don't think this is the appropriate forum to discuss, you know.
That was brought up, and he discussed it and, you know, talked about withdrawing from Belcher Town. But that isn't what the Board of Selectmen is saying over there when I read the paper.
Yeah, so that's Belcher Town's business, though, I think. So in terms of Hadley's business with the COG, does anybody here have anything further for them?
We absolutely acknowledge there's a second side to that, Mr. Pipchinsky.
Okay.
Okay, thank you for coming.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Appreciate it. Thank you, everyone. And again, reach out if we can be of any additional service.
Okay, we will.
Thank you very much.
All right, so can we get back to those budgets that we didn't quite get through?
Doc, tell me I missed her.
Vice versa.
So we're going back to the 100?
Yeah, so let's pick it up from the 100 level budget. So on page 42.
Pick up in advance of this. Okay.
Okay, so on page 42, there are two budgets presented. The first one is the moderator. That's $100. That's required by law. It's level funded. The second budget is 122. That is the select board budget. The select board budget covers a part-time position and a full-time position. It covers the select board salaries. I've made only one adjustment to the entire budget. That's a reduction in the PVPC smart growth line item from 1,000 to 800 because we never spend $1,000. So that budget decreased by a little less than 1%. Moving on to page 43, account 129, that's the town administrator account. That budget increased by 1.73%. Almost all of that is a contractual increase for my salary. I decreased the mileage and meal account again by about $200 in order to match that to historical pattern. If anybody has any questions, feel free to interrupt me. I'm just going to keep on plowing forward. Page 48, bottom of the page, account 151, that's the legal budget. That increased by almost 10%, an increase of $4,120. That increase is entirely driven by the concern that I have about the new public records law, the ability for requesters to take the town to court at any time of the process. So that entire process, that entire increase is driven entirely by the public records law.
Didn't we increase that budget last year by $5,000 because we were concerned regarding litigation on North Maple Street that was not used? We're actually going up, but from 2 years ago, we're up $9,000.
Well, we actually did increase the budget by $5,000 during the budget preparation season. At the very last, we withdrew that $5,000, so it was level funded from FY16 into 17, and I'm recommending that we increase it from 17 to 18 by $4,120.
Truly feel it's an issue.
I think we should level fund it and see what else is out there.
My question was, do you truly feel that's an issue, that we're going to run into problems with this?
I think we can take a little bit longer view of this as we get into April. We can take another look at that increase.
I guess the question is, do we build it in, or do we react to it, and if we need to, be looking at a reserve fund transfer?
Yeah. I mean, trying to look in my crystal ball, I'm thinking we're going to see more legal activity on having to do with public records. If we want to take it out, we can certainly do that.
I just didn't take it out. Take it's an unknown.
I understand your concern. I hope that it's not an issue.
I hope it's not an issue either.
I understand.
Yeah. How's everybody else feel about that?
I understand why he did it.
Yeah, I do too.
Oh, yeah, I understand why he did it. It's not being critical, but just thinking maybe we don't need to.
Sometimes when you take it out, you can't get it back.
Well, that's to say we would have to rely on the reserve fund or something.
How much we have in the reserve.
You're actually looking at level funding that line, not adding to it.
Exactly.
Is it the combined will of the board that we're going to level fund that budget?
Finance, have a view.
Quick question.
Sure.
Past the last two actuals, how variable has the actuals been for 5, 10 years?
It depends upon the year. A lot of this is driven by personnel issues and not litigation. We have seen some litigation in the past. We've tended to fund the major litigation separately. But to the extent that we can control our personnel issues, we can keep this level funded.
Thank you.
Madam Chair, the only question I really have is when we're billed and we need the services of an attorney in town for, like, say, a police hearing, town meeting, are we billed from when they leave Boston until they get here?
No.
How does that work?
Okay, so KP Law is our attorney. They have offices in Boston and Northampton. I think they also have offices in Worcester and maybe another town. The ride from Boston to Northampton is free, and then the ride from Northampton to here is billed.
Closest office.
Yeah, closest office.
Okay, so that's a new terminology. Okay.
Okay, so are we comfortable? I mean, again, this isn't final, but we're just going to take that 4,000 out for now.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. All right, moving right along, the next one that we're going to look at is the property insurance 193 on page 52. I've level funded this budget. For a couple of reasons, one of which is your safety committee has done a remarkable job of reducing our exposure for property insurance risk and claims. We've received an award for excellence in loss control. That has resulted in a commitment from the Massachusetts and Interlocal Insurance Agency to have a 0% increase for FY18 and a no more than a 2% increase for FY19. So we also have received many grants through the safety committee's work, as well as many credits for our insurance program. So that being said, it looks like we can level fund this budget. The
selectmen sitting too hilariously boring meetings at the MIA.
The only issue about this particular budget is that we won't actually have our assessment until after town meeting, so sometimes there'll be a change in property value, and I just want to point out that we did upgrade the two sewer pump stations, and that could have an impact upon the property insurance. The next ones
are... Can I make one comment?
Sure.
And I think we owe a debt of thanks to a former selectman that I served with 30 years ago, John Allen. When this MIAA insurance was in its infancy, John was sitting on the e-board, and he implemented most of this stuff in its infancy, and we're receiving the benefits of today because of his hard work. He was an agent for Northwestern, and he had his own business here in Hadley and dedicated many hours to this to get it off and running. And
I bet my bottom dollar he's at home listening, so I'm sure he appreciates
that. Well, I would hope so.
I don't think we should forget Susan Glovatsky either, who worked in the industry, who was able to bring a lot of things to light.
That's
as
true.
To how we were able to utilize that service.
Okay, anything else, David?
Bottom of the page 52, the senior center. This is an operational budget. This is what we need to expend in order to keep the lights on, the water flowing, the heat on, and so forth. You'll notice that that budget has been decreased by more than 22%. All of those decreases are transfers from operational budget to building maintenance budget. So that $10,350
decrease to that budget is simply transferred over to the 490 budget. We'll talk about that budget next week.
Okay.
The next page, page 53, the town hall. Again, this budget decreased by more than 11%. And again, all of that is a transfer of $8,200 from this budget over to the 490 building maintenance budget in an effort to consolidate our building maintenance effort and control it a lot more centrally through the DPW. North Hadley Village Hall, that has been decreased 100%. We are mothballing that building. There is no need to expend anything in terms of electricity or oil or anything on that building. Now, North Hadley Village Hall is broken into two sections. There's the northern section where the park and rec formerly used to be, the library formerly used to be, and then the southern wing, which is where the fire engines are right now. The fire department pays for the operational costs of that southern part. So the heating and the electricity and the alarms and then the water for the fire portion of that building is paid for separately. And then finally, the next page, page 54, budget 199, that's the Russell School. That has been decreased by 20%. Again, reflecting the fact that we've mothballed that building, with the exception that we have a revolving account to maintain that building's operation as we rent it out to the contractor for the remainder of the Route 9 widening project. So any real operational budget that needs to happen on the Russell School is paid for through a revolving account. Then the only other budget we need to talk to is going back to page 59. This is for the ambulance. It's a $5,000 increase, and that's by contract. We contract for advanced life support, the ambulance through the town of Amherst. We're in a three-year contract. FY18 is the last year of the three-year contract. And you and I have been working on augmenting and perhaps replacing that service with another service. And I'll be bringing information back to the board on that at a later date. But for right now, $140,000 for an advanced life support ambulance service, where somebody else takes on all the liability, all the risks, all the capital expenses, personal expenses, consumable supplies. It's a bargain.
Madam Chair?
Yes.
Can I get an update on the ambulance committee? I know we appointed them 8 months ago, and I don't believe they met yet.
That is absolutely.
You know, so what is the update on that? Because there's crucial information that they're going to need to provide to us to negotiate this contract.
Yes, and so I think that was what David was referring to. We've been working hard to try to make that ambulance committee happen. Our chief has had difficulty getting it scheduled, so at this point, I think your most recent conversation was Mike was going to kick that off within the next few weeks. Well, have it scheduled, right.
Yeah.
And so likely first meeting would be within the next few weeks, and if that doesn't happen, then we will forge ahead anyway.
Yep.
So that's where we're at.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, yep. Good question. Okay, so we also, anything from the...
Can we publicize a request for information on an ambulance contract and see what's out there?
Well, that's the work of the ambulance committee. Is.
Why can't we do that right now? We've been doing that for 4 years now, and here we are at the last year again.
Well, we want to make sure it's in an appropriate format so that when that RFI goes out, right? So we have the whole from the previous ambulance committee. We have that all.
Because we have it recommendations
in the can.
Back then.
Yeah.
We have an RFP in the can. We just need to tighten it up. But the main thing is that that RFP was written 10 years ago.
Yeah. So it really just needs to be updated, but I think we can get that done with a very short order and get it out the door, to your point. So, okay, anything else on the budgets for this evening, Finance Committee? No? Okay, so thanks, sorry that it got broken up that way, but, okay. All right, so we're going to roll into our regular select board agenda.
Next week, 6:30 again?
Yes, 6:30 again next week for budget reviews.
And do they know which we're going to be discussing next week?
Yes, they do.
Great.
Okay.
Our new people as well?
Yep. David reached out to everybody. Okay, so call, any questions, whatever. Okay, thank you. And you're more than welcome to stay for the rest of the evening.
Not a fat chance.
Okay, so going into the regular select board agenda, the first item of business is public, the consent agenda and then public comment. So for the consent agenda, we have minutes from February 1st and 15th for approval. We have four warrant articles, and we have a one-day liquor license requested by Pyramid Mall of Hadley.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, moved and seconded. Any discussion?
Police and fire looked over that permit.
So it's actually the Amherst area of Chamber of Commerce is having an event at Pyramid Mall. It's an all-alcoholic one-day license. It's been vetted by police fire. We're ready to go on that one.
All right.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay. Public comment briefly, if there's any.
I just have a little one. I thought David was going to handle this for me, but he forgot about it. I know we talked about this. This was this afternoon in a staff meeting. We talked about this many months ago, and finally it's become a reality. Can you hand these down so you can see these? And then I'll explain them further.
Oops, sorry.
That's 1, 2, 3, 4.
Put that down there.
Okay, what I'm talking about is a retirement party for our Hadley Highway and Water Superintendent that retired after 42 years of service. The date is going to be April 1, 2017 at the American Legion, and it's going to be 6 to 10 p.m., a dinner dance, $20 a ticket, and it's going to include the gift. Graciously, the American Legion has waived their fees for use of the hall, and so we don't run into any problems. My suggestion, if it's all right with the board, if there's any extra money left after we meet all our applications for this event, that the money would go to a charitable organization like the American Legion.
Not up for the board to say.
Yeah.
So how do we do
it? No, just the organizers of the event can do that.
Okay, and Mr. Waskevich graciously accepted to work with me on this, so, and
does
we've got other people, huh? Yes, he does, and his wife and him both agree, and the date is okay,
just
so
making sure. Yeah.
We're all set.
It's not a joke.
Congratulations, and April Fool's Day.
Yeah. All right, thank you for doing that.
And we've got the tickets made up. I just got to get them.
Okay.
Everything's in the works for tomorrow.
Okay,
posters
good.
Will be posted in the adequate places where tickets are for sale, and things of that nature.
Okay. All right. Yes, sir.
Are you guys putting on anything for the infrastructure in the sewer? For this town meeting warrant to basically camera the entire system?
That's
There's
capital planning.
Money raised at the this year for that.
How much?
Gosh, what was it, $32,000, I think it was?
You're not going to do very much.
Okay, so we've already gone through the appointments. We did Route 9, so Fire Substation and Senior Center RFQ finalists. So, Jane, you want to start?
I think you all got the letter from Colliers.
Yep.
The committee interviewed 5 people, and we have sent you our results for the top 3, any one of whom would be wonderful, but we're really happy with our first choice. EDM, who pairs with Lifespan Association, which is a company out of Ohio that specifically works on senior centers, and nationwide they've done 50 senior centers. Their history is, it's a husband-wife team. He's an architect and she was a senior center coordinator, advisor, director, and then they started seeing the need for building senior centers that were functional for seniors.
Mm-hmm. So the action item for the select board is to accept the ranking of the 3 architects for the senior center. and to authorize the building committee to negotiate a price and bring that back for final award.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, moved and seconded. Any further discussion or questions for Jake?
I guess my only question would be, now you said this company is located where?
EDM, which is the main overseer, is in Pittsfield in Connecticut.
Okay.
And they're pairing with a company that's in Ohio, who will come here for all of the conversations. This is the company that did the Chicopee Senior Center.
Which you reviewed.
And we have been there, we visited it, we're very impressed with the kinds of things that they have insight towards. Mm-hmm. Things you don't think about. Mm-hmm. Not that we're going to have a stairway in ours because we're on one level, but in this Chicopee one, because it had to be on two levels because of the location, their stairway has handrails at three different heights depending upon the mobility or the size of the person. Mm-hmm. They're just little things that you don't think of, but people who do this all the time pick it right up.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So I would like to request to be on next week's warrant to come back with our negotiated price.
You betcha.
And hopefully next week after you approve the contract price, which of course the OPM is doing, not really us.
Motion on second on the floor, Chair.
Sorry.
I'm just letting you finish.
We hope we could get a letter of intent so we could start.
Okay. All right, so motion made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay, thank you. Thank you in the committee. And then next we have the Hadley Fire Substation Building Committee recommendations. Is that you, Mr. Michkowski?
We sent a letter. We zeroed down to two applicants. And you got the list there. What I did, I went out and asked them to supply nine more references, which I followed through, and I went by the rating. Questions, some of the questions that OPM put together, and then I added some more. And it was on a rating from 1 to 10. And every single community came back with a number 10 being the highest rating on it. It was just excellent. It's, the company is local, so there's no problem of being here on time and no delays with it. On budget. And just there was a couple other things involved in this. I called Natural Heritage. There's an endangered species on that premises. But according to their map, and I talked to the woman there, she called me the other day from Boston, and she said the town is exempt from that because it's a planned field, it's not, you know, overgrown and cactails and everything, so that's not going to be a problem there. I asked the number two applicant on the list to send me 10 more references in case the first reference is not negotiated, or something happens, they don't accept it. We're going to have a backup, but we're going to be assured that that is the right thing, because okay. The committee felt if we don't take these two, we'll throw it out, throw the bids out, and go out to bid again.
Did you get reference on the second committee as well, on second choice?
He was, yeah, we had five originally. This is that in addition.
Did you get the other 10 yet, or no?
No, he was supposed to email me, and today I'm going to have to call him tomorrow. I haven't got him yet.
Okay.
So the action item for the board is to accept the ranking of the architects and to authorize the committee to go out and negotiate a price.
So
bring that back to the select board for approval.
Second.
Okay, moved and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay, all right, thank you.
Can I ask when are your next scheduled meeting to do that we need to bring this back to you by?
Well, we're meeting the 8th and the 15th, right?
Mm-hmm. Next two Wednesdays we're meeting.
Next two Wednesdays we're meeting.
Okay. If it works for you.
It doesn't happen the 8th to 15th.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
I thought we were leaving these on the agendas on a weekly basis anyway.
Yeah, as we had talked about, making sure that we always have a placeholder for both projects.
Okay.
Yep.
So then there's two bids for each project, one bid having to do with the geotech services analysis, and the other having to do with the soil phase one analysis for both fire substation and the senior center. For the fire substation for geotech, the recommended outfit is Costa Consulting Engineers, and for the soil analysis, ATC Group Services. I make a recommendation that the bids be awarded to those two companies for those projects as listed.
Okay. Second.
Motion made and seconded. Any questions or further discussion on those bids?
Note on that is the lowest bid.
It's not the lowest bid for the geotech service. There was a tie between Costa Consulting Engineers and O'Reilly, Talbot, and Okun. They were both coming in at $4,500. Review of the references, based upon the review of the references, Costa Consulting Engineers emerged as the preferred choice.
But it truly was the lowest bid. It was a
no,
tie.
No, it's not the lowest bid. It was a tie.
Yeah.
It was one of the lowest.
One of the lowest bids.
Yeah. One of the lowest bids.
Yeah. Okay.
The soil was different. The soil analysis is that the low bid was $2,500. The next bid was $2,800.
Okay. Motion made and seconded on the geotech.
Senior Center geotech and phase one soil analysis.
All right. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Okay. And anything further?
Nope. We're good.
Okay. Excellent. We have water and sewer abatement, 3 Scott Lane.
This is a result of an estimated water bill, water and sewer bill, because we did not have access to the water meter, and when we did get to the water meter, we understood that we overshot the estimate. So the recommendation is an abatement of $40.24.
I'll move.
Second. Motion made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. So I'm sorry, I read this wrong. $29.17 for water and $53.08 for sewer.
Again.
Motion made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Have they updated that particular street with the new automatic readers yet or not?
I'll have to look into it. I don't know the answer.
Okay, so we have two remaining agenda items. We have the annual town meeting consent agenda articles, and we have the opening of the warrant for the CPA articles. So I just want to check in with our audience. Is anybody here for anything in particular? No? Just hanging out? Just making sure? Okay. So, yes, sir?
There's one thing I forgot to ask the boy.
Oh.
I did call DOT for the traffic light, the street traffic lights to stop traffic there.
North Hadley Fire Station.
Right, that's not a state issue, that's a town issue. And I'm asking the board, do they have any objections that I follow through to get that, the permitting or whatever needed? I think everything has to be done with this board. It's not the state though, not the DOT. Are you guys in support of that?
I absolutely am in support of that.
Yeah.
Thank you. Okay.
Anybody and have I'm any sure issue the
neighborhood,
with that?
Donald, I'm sure the neighborhood would be totally
supportive. Oh, definitely.
Yeah.
There's already one there to slow traffic down after the S curve and before the other curve, but it's just speed. But this is completely different, I realize
traffic
it.
Rate though.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right, David, the consent agenda,
okay,
you just want to point out the articles?
So. We normally play, well, we've gotten into the practice of putting articles that are non-controversial and not terribly substantive on what's called a consent agenda so that we can streamline our work at the town meeting. Our consent agenda last year included the first 3 articles. Article 1 is for the grants. We have to take a vote annually so that we can expend grant and gift money without going back to town meeting for an appropriation. So this is an all-inclusive vote. Article 2, this would cover our ability to receive and expend Chapter 90 type money to address our roads and bridges in town, and we get about $300,000 annually for this, so this is an important vote. Article 3, the short-term borrowing. If we ever got into a cash situation where we needed to borrow against anticipated future receipts, this would give us the ability, with the Select Board's approval, of course, to borrow on a temporary basis, short-term loan, in order to meet an obligation and pay that back with future money. This has never happened to us. We've come close once, but it's there for the safeguard. So I recommend those first three articles.
Okay. So you want us to vote to actually approve them tonight, or
so that we can get these slam dunks out of the way?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, motion made and seconded. All in favor?
Is this all that you're going to put on that, or are we going to come back later and do
I'm going to go to the other three in a moment, but these are the stock articles that we do every year. There's a little bit more discussion involved in the next ones coming up.
Why don't we hold the discussion until, why don't we hold the vote until the six have been discussed?
All right. Article.
There's a motion and a second on the floor. I'm just asking if we can amend the motion.
We can defer.
I'll withdraw my second.
Let's get them all at once.
You want to withdraw your motion?
Whatever.
Yeah.
Okay.
Formality.
Whatever.
Article 5, this is a fund balance transfer, and this is something that we've put into practice at the last town meeting, of going back over the old articles where we've expended money and we have very small balances left. And we simply want to clean those up and return the money back to the original fund that funded this. So for example, we have DPW loader and plow. The original appropriation was something like $90,000. We have $90 left in that. We can return that to the capital stabilization account. So this is housekeeping, and just tidying up old articles so that we don't have our balance sheet cluttered with unproductive money that no longer needs to be there. We're still developing this article. You'll notice that there's some question marks about this, but in concept, I'm asking that the board support the idea that we just clean out the underbrush and return balances back to where they can be used productively for other purposes.
This is a recommendation from the treasurer, right?
We do this every year.
No, we haven't. And that's part of the problem. We hadn't been.
No,
but we have.
No, last year we did.
Yes,
right,
we did.
So this will be the second time that we've done this.
Yep.
Right. Second year in a row, then. Seems like every year.
Can we draft our articles that say that this can be done automatically as opposed to going back and wasting town meetings?
Some towns do that. That if you don't use the money in a 3-year period, then it goes back to. The problem is that when you get into borrowing articles, it doesn't work that way. So we have to take an active vote to return borrowed amounts, or to reduce the amount of borrowing that's no longer needed, so that we can free up that capacity for other purposes.
That $2,500 for Station 1 and 4. Was that the rest of the engineering that wasn't paid, or was there actually a balance left there?
You know, I don't know. This is an account that I saw that was sticking out like a sore thumb, and I said, let's throw it in there. We can tighten this up.
They just finished the engineering on it, and I believe we just got the copies, and I think that number looked like the number that the balance was pulled.
I'm happy to, if you need that money for a productive purpose, I'm happy to allow it to remain.
Well, no, probably just check with Marlo on some of these issues here.
The intent of this article is housekeeping. It's not to take money away from an active project. So the next consent article is, navigate my way through there, is number 7. And number 7 is the annual payment that we make to the Water Plant Filtration Stabilization Fund in order to fund the next replacement of the water cartridges. We had been putting in $10,000 per year. Last year, we put in $20,000, and now with the estimated costs 10 years out for replacing of those water cartridges, we were recommending $26,000 to be placed into that stabilization fund for future use, and that way in 10 years we'll have $260,000 for that project.
Next.
And then 15 is the CPA required article. This is
30-30-30.
You'll notice that the administrative fee has gone up to $15,000. This is on page 14. So the administrative fee has gone up by to $15,000. It had been $5,000 2 years ago, went up to $10,000, now it's up to $15,000. And the CPA committee is putting together a spending plan, and they're using the services of the Pioneer Valley Planning Commission in order to do that. So that money is there for their administrative costs, plus the costs of working with PVPC in order to put together a spending plan, which is required by law. Okay. That's it?
That's it?
Yep.
We don't actually have full figures in the other one, so we can't vote it.
Yeah.
Well, we didn't, that's in the omnibus budget. Where's that piece we were going to talk about this week about whether or not putting money into the stabilization account?
So that is in your, that's in your budget.
Omnibus.
And it would be in the omnibus budget.
All right, we don't need to do that
and
tonight.
And it would be under the 900 level budgets.
That's up for discussion, correct?
Yep.
It is up for discussion.
Tell me again what this 15,000 is for.
So their expenses that the CPA committee runs into, legal
expenses.
It used
to be for mailing and envelopes.
Mailings,
yeah.
Envelopes,
okay. And
legal.
$5,000.
That was $5,000.
That was never spent, I mean, never maxed.
Rarely spent, never maxed. They're required to come up with a spending plan. This is a requirement of state law, and they've contracted with Pioneer Valley Planning Commission in order to do that work, and so they want to make sure that they have that money. This would come out of CPA general funds anyways.
What does the spending plan do?
Well, I think it would give us a clearer idea as to how to move forward with the CPA committee, particularly since we have $1.8 million in that account, and it doesn't seem like that we're able to do anything other than make it grow. So I'm all in favor of coming up with a plan to tell us in the future how are we going to manage that money responsibly.
Did the CPA have the meeting with the COG on the preservation money for the courthouse?
No.
Not yet?
Not yet.
Okay. That's, I was just wondering how that worked with them, or
yeah,
if there was any comments.
That's coming up.
Okay.
Okay, then the last regular item is we have the CPA is requesting that we open the warrant for a few articles.
Right, so we have, it's actually the Conservation Commission is requesting with coordination with the CPA account that we add four articles to the warrant. The first is an amendment to a land preservation vote that we've already taken on the Heron Estate off of Lawrence Plain Road. Approximately 17 acres. We've already voted this. The state went ahead and redid their appraisal and came up with a higher value for the property, and they're asking the town to cover that higher value. That's a $9,000 expense. There are two articles that are presented here. One is for CPA funds for $4,500. And then the other one would be from the Transfer of Development Rights Fund for $4,500. Now, CPA has $1.8 million in it, so they can certainly cover this expense. And the Transfer of Development Rights has about $145,000 in it, $45,000 of which is earmarked for another project, so it's $100,000 that's available for this project. So that's the first.
Under what shortfall did that occur?
That shortfall came from the state doing the appraisal, coming up with a higher value, and according to the state rules, they're not able to meet the difference, so the town would have to...
Higher value on the property?
Yes.
So as opposed to it being $10,000 an acre for APR, they're looking for additional funds from the town?
That's correct.
So it's really nothing coming out of general budget, it's coming out of CPA anyway, so...
Yeah, there's no impact on taxation.
I'm afraid of the precedence that's going to set.
What they use for justification for the increase? Do you know?
The Heron estate has taken a long time to go through property values rise over time.
Have they ever done this on any other property?
This has never happened to me before.
And we're not approving these articles. We're really being asked to put them on town meeting floor. We'd have plenty of time to speak to them.
Exactly. Yeah. You're being asked to include these four articles.
I'd like to get an explanation for it.
I'd like to have CPA and Conservation come in and speak to us regarding these two things.
Okay.
Before we put it on the warrant?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
All right, so the second article is, two articles is for a new APR, which has just come up for the West property, 107 acres off of South Maple Street, and the total cost of that would be $50,000 to the town, 25 of it would come from CPA funds, and the other 25 would come from the TDR account.
It looks to me as though the state is now looking for a partner to fund these mechanisms.
I think there are two different stories here.
This is just one up.
The revisit on the Heron estate, and this one is a new one. The West property is a new APR.
But again, we've never funded mechanism this way.
Yes, you have.
This is the normal way we do it.
That's the way it's always been done, actually.
For
CPA funds has been used to fund
APRs? Yeah.
Yeah.
Not the only thing they do fund. In the capital plan, every year we have $100,000 from CPA that is dedicated to land preservation. So this would fit within our capital plan.
I'll make a motion to accept that one.
Is there a second?
Yeah, I'll second it.
Okay. Motion made and seconded for the two West property-related CPA articles. Any further discussion on those? If not, all in favor of putting that on the warrant?
Aye.
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 Okay. Okay, so David, will you reach out to CPA and Conservation about the Heron estate?
I don't know why we can't put that other one, the last one, on either. I mean,
I think Jerry's concerned.
No, he can bring up a motion.
Yeah, I mean, we can pass over it on the floor just to get it out of the way and put it on it. Like we do otherwise.
But we can also have them come in and give us an explanation also.
Yeah, have them give them an explanation, but put it on a warrant for now anyway.
I think the concern is once it goes, well, could remove it from the warrant, couldn't we?
Yeah,
you can always take it off. You can always pass over it, or you can...
You know, we got a minute right now to do it and get it over with, so...
Okay, you make a motion?
Yeah, make a motion to
is there a second
put it on a warrant.
Second to John's motion?
I'll second that.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Opposed? Okay. Okay, that concludes the regular agenda. And does anybody have any announcements before we adjourn?
I do. Don't want to cut in front of you, Joyce.
I'll go. I can go last. Don't worry.
Do you have a meal?
I do.
There's going to be another cornhole tournament coming up, and it's going to be at the Hadley American Legion Post 271. And it's going to be to benefit Riverside Industries, and it's in the memory of Richie Cook's son, Kenny Cook, and Katie Mills, who was Richie Cook's, who used to, Kenny sit, we'd say Kenny sit. In my house we say Pat sit, but that's Kenny sit. Take care of Kenny. They both passed away. And in an effort to raise some money to help with Riverside Industries, Richie's put together a cornhole tournament. It's going to be Sunday, March 26th. Registration's at 12:30. To 1 o'clock, and the tournament begins at 1. Food, fun, and prizes will be available. For information or to sign up, please contact the American Legion or area code 413-320-1524.
Thank you.
Okay. Anything else? Joyce?
I do have my two condolences for this evening. One is of Larry Kelly. He has a brother that lives here in Hadley, so to his family, we send our condolences. I've known Larry, and I'm sure most people here have known him over the years, and it was quite a sudden loss for all of us in the community of Amherst. And the other one was Amelia Zafer today, who passed away at a good age, and she certainly lived a good life, and she was the lady that we bought property for our school and safety complex.
That's right.
And so to her family, we sent our condolences.
It was a great obituary. How many people got to be a nurse to Babe Ruth and to Ed Kennedy? That was, I never knew her. I knew Millie, too. I never heard a word out of her regarding that, so I thought that was
kind of... Can I add a little point of interest? I negotiated the land with Mrs. Zafer and her son Stanley. Originally, it was appraised at $750,000, negotiated to $525,000. For 17 and a half acres, that truly is a gift from the Zafer family today, you know, and we have our elementary school, our safety complex there, and we can't thank them enough.
Motion to adjourn.
Okay, anything else?
Second.
Okay, motion made and seconded. Good night, everybody.